Okay, so this afternoon, I'm not going to talk about PDMPs because statistics for PDMPs is too complicated, basically. But you will hear about it on a special example in Marie-Dou Mix Talks, I think. And she will most probably talk about the same data set as I'm going to show you. So you will see it today, not from the PDMP point of view, but from tomorrow on, you can see the same data set studied from a PDMP point of view. So there is a connection. So what I want to do this afternoon is take you in another land, in the land of statistics. In the land of statistics, you collect data, and you need to get information from this data. So I will present you two data sets from biological experiments that I'm going to comment. Then I will do a very, very fast crash course in statistics, for those of you who are not familiar with it. And I'll tell you how we run an analysis of the two data sets. And then I'll present a small conclusion. So let's go. The two data sets I'm going to talk about arise from the same biological question, which is there aging for single-cell organisms? Take a bacterium. Here in my example, it will be Escherichia coli. E. coli is just one single cell. When it replicates, the two daughter cells have the same genetic material, so they are clones. And the question is there a way to say one is older than the other? One is different from the other. Can we measure that? Are they exactly the same or not? Of course, for a complex human being like us, it's easy to see aging signs because you see, you go from small to adults and then you age. But for on a bacteria, it's not an obvious question to know if bacteria age or not. And this question is the same as, is cell division completely symmetric? Are the two offspring exactly the same or not? Okay? And it can be linked also to some kind of biological question, like, is cell material equally divided between daughter cells? You can imagine that you have plenty of things and plenty of molecules in the cell, and where could the difference come from? It's not completely understood, but the difference could come from the separation of material in small numbers. For instance, if you have three items of some molecules, you cannot divide them by 1.5 and 1.5. You have to have either 0, 3, or 1 or 2. So the asymmetry could come from this phenomenon. Okay, so how can you distinguish between two daughter cells of E. coli? E. coli is a rod-shaped bacterium like this, and when it grows, it gets longer. And as it gets longer, it will divide into two daughter cells in its middle, more or less, like this, okay? So here you have colors, and it's possible to track the two poles in experiments. You can see like this with the blue and red colors. Say you have one blue end and one red end. So in the beginning, you cannot differentiate from any of them, so just toss a coin and say this one is blue, this one is red, okay? Then there is a first division here. What happens at division? You have the creation of a new membrane of the cell in the middle. So here, it's the new pole of the cell in the middle. It's just been created at division. And then the other end of the cell is the old one inherited from the mother. And here, if I randomly say this is 0, this is 1, then it is one division old. Older than the previous one, so you get a 1 here, and this one, which was 1, it became 2. And if I do that from second generation, again, this cell will grow, it will be elongated, it will divide in the middle, create a new membrane in the middle, and inherit the old one from its mother. So now, after 2 generations, I can completely distinguish between the two sister cells here, because this one has inherited the new pole of its mother, the one that had been created at the previous division, and this one has inherited the old pole of its mother, the one that pre-existed before. Okay? And this is a way to distinguish between the two daughter cells. If I see at least two generations, I can say that one inherits the new pole of its mother and one inherits the old pole of its mother. And this is something that can be tracked down in experiments. Okay, so here is what my first data sets look like. The experiment is just take one bacterium and let it grow and track it. So you can see, so I'm not showing you the film, but just some snapshots, but you can find the film on the internet. You have the cells that grow and grow and grow and divide, and you can measure everything, and you can track down which is the daughter of which, and which one is the old pole cell, and which one is the new pole cell. So you have all the information you need. And what is the thing you want to measure here to say that, okay, you can say there is this so-called old pole cell and new pole cell. Why should the old pole cell be older? You can measure its growth rate, and what the biologists did from this experiment is that they obtained this kind of figure, and their conclusion is that the cell that inherits the old pole exhibit a diminished growth rate, decrease of offspring production, and an increased incidence of death. So the old pole cell can be interpreted as older one. It has aged, it's less efficient, it grows slower. So what you have here, the dots, I'll get back to them later on, is you have here the cells that have inherited from one old pole from the mother, and then you have two old poles consecutively, and then three, and then four, and then five, and if you suppose it's getting there, as the figure shows, it gets worse and worse. Okay? And on the contrary, on top, you have the cells that have always inherited the new poles from the mother. So once, twice in a row, three times, four times, etc., and they seem to be getting better and better. Okay. So when this paper was published, another team of biologists said, okay, it's really interesting, this aging thing. So let's make another experiment where we see the rest of the curve here. What happens next? So that's what they did with another experimental device called the mother machine, where you trap the cell in a kind of tube like this, and you have a flow of fresh medium so that they keep feeding, because of course if you change, if there is not enough food, you will change the dynamics. And you see that the cell that is trapped at the end of the tube here is always the old one, because the new pole is always created there and it goes away. So on the previous experiment, you have the whole binary tree of division. Here, instead of seeing the whole binary tree, you just follow this lineage here, where you have the accumulated old pole cells, okay? So here is what the films look like. Again, it's not a film, but a snapshot. You see the cell growing in each of the tube, and growing, and growing, and so on. And the main advantage over the other experimental device is that then you can do that for many, many, many generations. And what do they observe? You have here their curves of the growth rates. Does it decrease? Absolutely not. Their conclusion is our analysis reveals a remarkable stability of growth, whereby the mother cell inherits the same pole for hundreds of generations. So if you have inherited the so-called old pole for hundreds of generations, you would expect from the previous experiment to see your growth rate to go really down and go to death, but you don't. So the question is, are the two experiments in contradiction or not? If not, why not? And then, is the division of E. coli really symmetric or not? One experiment says yes, the other says no. So then we need a statistical analysis of both data sets to try to answer this question, and that's the question I'm going to address in this talk, okay? So now, for those of you who are familiar with statistics, you can now take a nap, go to sleep for about 15 minutes, and I'll wake you up when I'm finished. So for those of you who are not familiar with statistics, here is some very, very basic course. What is a statistical approach? First, you need to collect data. Because biologists did this on this experiment, great, we don't need to do that. Then the first thing you want to do when you have the data is to have some exploratory or descriptive statistics. You want to summarize the information, you want to represent it graphically, you want to see what it looks like. And then the first problem arises, because to do that, you need a lot of data formatting and pre-processing. And it is usually the hard work of the statistician. The data are almost never ready to use. You need to transform them a lot to get the information. Okay. The next step is to do the inferential statistics, which means a parameter estimation to validate or invalidate some hypothesis given the data. To do that, you need a stochastic model because you need to know which parameters you want to estimate. And sometimes it's too complicated to get a stochastic model, so you are happy with just statistic model where you look for links between variables that may not be mechanical links, it's not an explanation, but it's just say you have a correlation between your data. So this is a classical statistical approach, very summarized. A bit more detail about inferential statistics, so parameter estimation. Given a model and some realization of the model, some data, you want to estimate its parameters. How can you do that? You have basically four different ways to do it. For example, your model is just a normal distribution with mean m and variance sigma squared. You have some IID realization of the model, and you want to estimate the parameters of interest, which are traditionally called theta, and here it's your mean and your variance. And what is an estimator? An estimator, it's a quantity that is computable from the data, and that approximates your unknown parameter. Okay? So what is the first way to build an estimator? It's what is known as the empirical method, and it's based on the law of large numbers. So you know, if you take the mean of a random identically distributed random variable and independent, it will converge to its expectation. So like this, if the parameter you want to estimate can be written as the expectation of something, you have a very simple estimator like this. Second family of method is the least squares method, where you want to minimize some quadratic error. You want to select the best estimator in some family in order to minimize, usually, a quadratic error. So you want, for instance, if you have a regression model like this, you observe x and y, you have this unknown noise here, you want to estimate the parameters a and b. How do you do that? You take the difference between your observed y and a plus bx that you have observed, you take it to the square, you add, and you minimize over a and b, and this is a completely standard least squares regression. Third method is known as the method of moments. And so again, it's a bit like the empirical method, but slightly different. If your parameters can be expressed in terms of the moments of your distribution, but may not be the exact moments, it may not be exactly the expectation, may not be the exactly the variance, you are going to write as many moments as you need in order to have enough equations to identify your parameters, and you are going to try to solve these equations in order to retrieve your parameters. And the last big family of method is called the maximum likelihood method, where you want to maximize the likelihood of your model given your observation. So here again, I give you an example with the normal distribution. And this is usually a very efficient method, except that you need to know the distribution of your data in advance. And sometimes you do not want to make assumption on the distribution. So if you don't know the distribution, you cannot use a maximum likelihood method. Okay, so now you know how to build an estimator. Now, how can you tell if an estimator is good or not? What is your criterion? First, you would like your estimator to be without bias. What does it mean? It means that if you take the expectation of your estimator, you retrieve the original unknown parameter. If you cannot do that, the next best thing you can do is to have an estimator that is asymptotically without bias. It means that if you have enough observation, the expectation of your estimator will converge to the unknown parameter. Okay, this is the mean behavior of your estimator. Of course, it's not enough because you're going to have just one realization. So the mean behavior, okay, it's nice, but it doesn't give you much information. So how do you evaluate the error of estimation? Usually with some kind of quadratic risk, also known as the mean square error, MSE in abbreviation. You want to know the L2 difference between your estimator and the real parameter. And usually you can decompose this error in two terms, which are the variance of your estimator and the bias to the square. So here you recover the bias. So it's usually known as a bias variance decomposition. So you need to keep both of them as small as possible if you can. So the desirable properties of an estimator, as you would like it to converge as you get more and more data to the unknown parameter, almost surely if you can, in probability if you cannot. And you also would like it to have an asymptotic normality property, which means that you want to know the fluctuations about around this limit, and you would like to identify the limit distribution, usually a normal distribution, but not always. And this is useful to know the limit variance here because it helps you build confidence intervals and statistical tests, and I'm getting there. So what is a confidence interval? Say you have good estimator, you can compute it from your data, and then you have one value. Okay, the theory says, okay, if I had more data, it would converge to the real unknown value, but I don't have more data. So how can I know how sharp it is? To do that, I can build a confidence interval which will give me the probability that my unknown quantity is in a given interval, which can be written like this, where you have if the limit distribution is a normal one, you have the quantiles here of the normal distribution, and you can know that your unknown value is in this interval with high enough probability. So it gives you an idea of how far you are from convergence and what is the sharpness of your estimation. So it's really a useful information. Now, I told you in the beginning, you want to do a statistical approach in order to answer some questions. So at some point, you need to make decisions. And to make decisions, you are going to run what is called statistical tests. So what is a test? It is a decision rule that you are going to take depending given the data that you have and a test statistic. For instance, again, say your model is a normal distribution with unknown mean and variance. You have an IID sample, and you want to test if the mean is zero or not. How do you do that? You need to define two hypotheses, which are not symmetric. The first one is a null hypothesis, I zero. It is a working hypothesis, which you will keep unless the data say otherwise. So it's your working hypothesis. And then you need to define an alternative hypothesis, H1, which could be the contrary of H0, but it could also be a subset of the contrary. For instance, here in my example, I can test is the mean equal to zero against is it positive, or against is it negative, or again is it different from zero. Okay, I have a choice of the alternative. How do I take my decision? I compute the test statistics given my data, and I compare it to some threshold, which is usually a quantile of the target distribution. And if it's above the threshold, I will reject H0, say no, given the data, I cannot believe in H0, and then we say that the test is significant. And if the test statistic is below the threshold, usually we don't say that we accept H0, we say that we do not reject it. So there is no evidence against it in the data, but it doesn't mean that it's true. It just means that the data don't contradict H0. When is a test good? Well, it's good when you take the right decisions. There are two types of decisions. You believe in H0 or you believe in H1. You decide H0, you decide H1. And you have two truths. Either H0 is true or it's not, or H1 is true. So if you decide for H0 and H0 is true, right decision, no problem. If H0 is true, but you have decided H1, then you make what is called a type 1 error. If the truth is H1 and you have decided H1, right decision again, no problem. And if the truth is H1 and you have decided H0, you have a type 2 error. So the type 1 error is the probability to reject H0 wrongly, probability to reject H0 given that it's true. And usually is the one that you can calibrate. When you build your test, you set this probability. Usually you set it to be small enough because you want it small. So you typically you say alpha is 5%. Then the type 2 error, the probability to accept H0 wrongly. And this one is usually very, very difficult to compute in general. So it's important because it gives you just an idea how powerful your test is, and what is called the test power is just 1 minus this probability. So it's a probability to reject H0 given that H0 is false. So what do you want from a test? You want a small type 1 error and you want a high power. So how to build a test? Like I told you, first you set your type 1 error, typically 5%, maybe less, if you want something sharper. You need to find a test statistics. What is a good candidate for a test statistic? You must know its distribution or its limit distribution as n goes to infinity if you cannot know its exact distribution. And you want this distribution not to depend on any unknown parameter. So you want it to be a universal distribution, so that you can estimate its quantiles without any assumption on the parameters, at least under H0. And if you want a good test, you need to know the right distribution under H0, and for instance, you say it goes to infinity under H1. So for example, if you still have this rate of convergence for an estimator to a limit normal distribution, you cannot keep this as a test statistics because it depends on the unknown variance V square. So what you do is you divide by V square to have it to erase this parameter, and usually you take it to the square to use a chi-square distribution in terms of normal one. It's the usual thing to do, and then you have something that does not depend on the unknown parameter. You can compute it from the data. This distribution doesn't depend on any parameter. And you will decide that you accept H0, or you do not reject H0 if you have a low value of the test statistics. It will look like this. You have, does it look like something like that? You have your chi-square distribution. You have a 5% error here. So what does it mean? It means that the probability given H0, if you believe that you really follow the normal distribution and you really have this convergence, the probability to be above this threshold will be just 5%. So what do you decide? You decide that if you are above this threshold, you do not believe in H0. And if you are below, you believe in H0. Okay? Okay, so now everybody, you can wake up again. Let's get back to my two experiments. So my question are they in contradiction? And is the division of E. coli symmetric or not? My roadmap is just to apply the statistical approach I've described before. Data collection, it's already done, so I need to do all the rest. Starting from data formatting to statistical analysis. Let's get started with the first of the data sets, the one with the whole binary tree. What are the data? I didn't get the original continuous time data, but already pre-processed data where the growth rates have been computed. I got 94 files corresponding to 94 films. The files are identified with a date, and you see it's shortened. It has a longer name with the number of the experiment. And you have several columns like this. Plenty of information I don't need. For instance, the cell length, I'm not going to use it here. The border distance, I'm not going to use it. So I'm just interested in the log of the length rate, which means exactly the growth rate. So this is the column I need. And what do we have here? We have the indicator of old and new pole cells. I told you, you just toss a coin, so you have heads and tails, the H and the T's. And if you do it at least for two generations, you can exactly know which is the daughter of which. So you need to translate this into a binary tree to retrieve the genealogy of the data. How do you do that? The first cell will be numbered zero because you don't know and you have tossed a coin, so said it's a tail, so you cannot say which it is. Same for 0H, you don't know which type it is. Then one of the daughters of 0H is 0HH, so you have twice the same H, which means it's an old pole cell because it didn't change from the mother to the daughter. It's the same H. Then the other daughter will be H and T, and this one, there is a change, so it's a new pole cell. You can identify them. And then again, for the daughters of the first T, TH will be a new pole cell because you changed the letter, and TT will be the old pole cell because you got the same letter as your mother. And you can identify them, and then for the next generation, for instance, the last one, you have first a new pole, then an old one because you have the same letter, and you can scan the labels like this and determine exactly the position of each cell in the genealogical tree and decide if it's a new cell, if it's an old cell, and if it's been, if it has inherited consecutive old pole cells or consecutive new pole cells, or if it has changed. For instance, this one is twice new, and the last one will be one old, one new. Okay, so now from the original data, you can number the cells uniquely so that you know exactly where it is in the genealogical tree. So what we decided to do, for a reason I will explain in a moment, is that the original ancestor will be labeled one, and its two daughters, I will take one even daughter and one odd daughter. The one with the even number will be the new pole cell, and the one with the odd number will be the old pole cell. And how can I get from a daughter to its mother? I just divide it by two and take the integer part. Okay, so you exactly, if you know the number of a cell, you know exactly where it is in the genealogical tree. So this is for the pre-processing phase, which is quite easy in this for this example because there has been a lot of work done. From the 94 films, actually there are 94 files in which you have, in few of the files you have several trees, so you have more genealogical trees than films. We have 101 genealogical trees from this data. How far are they observed? They are observed up to 4 to 9 generations. In total, we have about 23,000 cells measurements with a growth rate. And we have a lot of missing data, and I'm going to get back to this later on, which means that there are some branches in the trees that I don't see. I don't have a complete binary tree. The measurement I'm interested in is the growth rate. And I know exactly which cell is old, which cell is new, and how many consecutive old or new pole I've got. And I know the genealogy, I know which is the daughter of which, and I know all the lineages, I have all this information. Okay, so next step is the exploratory analysis. I have 23,000 cells, I'm not going to show you the 23,000 growth rates because you won't see anything. So I give you just a summary of the data. So one summary I can do, and I'll get back to it in the end, is just box plots of the growth rates over the generations. So here I took all the data and I just sorted them by the second, third, fourth, etc. generation in each tree. And for those of you who are not familiar with this kind of drawing, what it means, the central line here is the median of the data, which means you have half of the data under, half of the data above. You have the 25 and 75% percentiles there, and you have the 5% and 95% of the data, and the ones that are above and below. So it gives you an idea of the dispersion of the data. Okay, so that was for all the trees pulled together, and if I just look at one single tree, I can see the same thing, but then I can plot all the measurements, and I can see that I have a lot of noise in this data, because in a given single tree, I have a lot of dispersion. Okay, so the first thing we try to do is to get the picture, say, get the same picture from the original paper of Stewart and its co-authors. So we had to work a little bit because there's not much detail in the original paper on how to get this picture. So our first try did absolutely not look like that. So what happens in this picture? It's not the raw data. They are normalized because there is a lot of noise. You see here, it starts from one, which means that they have been normalized to be at the same scale, all of them. So there is a normalization by the mean growth rates in each single tree. And the mean is taken on all cells sharing the same number of consecutive old or new poles in any of the trees. So of course, if you take a cell in two different trees, you can reasonably suppose that they're independent. But if you take two cells in the same tree, they have dependency connections because they are linked with the genealogy. So what is shown here is sort of confidence intervals, but pretending that all the data are independent and identically distributed, which is of course not true in this data. Again, because the cells from the same tree are not independent. So this picture is somehow false from a statistical point of view, because you shouldn't do that. So what you should do, and that's why we run new analysis, is really take into account the dependencies between the data using the genealogical tree structure. So each point again, each point in the previous picture corresponds to a very different number of cells. So first, you have ignored that they are dependent, and then you ignore another thing, is that cells that have inherited just one new pole, for instance, you have plenty of them, because at each division, one of the cells gets a new pole. So you have about half of them. But cells that have inherited, let's say, one, two, three times the new poles consecutively, you have very few of them, because it's just one specific location in the tree. So that's what you have in colors here. The colors are darker if you have more and more new poles or more and more old poles. So you see you have up to generation four, you have just two cells with three old ones in a row, and you have two cells with three new ones in a row. So you are in this picture, you are comparing points. There you have plenty of observations, and there you have very few. And you compare them on the same line as if they meant the same thing, which is, again, not true. So another point in favor of doing things differently. Okay, but of course, it's the first thing you want to do is pretend your data is IAD, see if you catch something, and then try to do it properly. So the data have a tree structure, and you need to take this into account. Okay. So, first question was, are the experiments in contradiction? Well, if you do not believe in the conclusion of the first graph, maybe not. So you need to finally say, is there asymmetry in this data or not, if you want to do it rigorously. Okay? So let's do that. Now, I want to test if the growth rate of the old pole cells and the growth rate of the new pole cells are statistically different or not, taking into account, again, the tree structure. Okay, so now I'm done with exploratory statistics, and I'm going to next step, which is inference. And I need a model, okay, to estimate my parameters and test symmetry. What do I want from this model? You start as simple as you can. So what is natural to assume is that the growth rate of a daughter cell depends on its mothers. Sounds reasonable. You want sister cells to be correlated because they are born at the same time, at the same place, so they shouldn't be independent. And you want to be able to test symmetry, so you want to allow non-symmetric models. So you want to allow two sister cells to have different growth rates. So the most simple model you can imagine to do that is a tree-valued autoregressive model. What do I mean by that? It's what is called the bar model for bifurcation autoregressive model. So here you have. Here, if instead of k, you add just, instead of 2k, you add k plus 1, you have the standard autoregressive model where your next value depends on the previous one plus some noise. Now it's a bit different because I have here the growth rate of the mother cell, and its two daughters are labeled 2k and 2k plus 1. That's how I numbered my cells. And I want an autoregressive structure, so very simple, linear. But I want to allow the parameters to be different. And then from the data, I'm going to try to estimate these parameters A, B, C, and D, and test if the couple AB is different from CD or not. That's my aim. Okay? So just so that you are all you all agree with the way I number my cells. So again, the original ancestor is 1. Its two daughters are 2 times 1 and 2 times 1 plus 1, so 2 and 3. And say 2 is the new pole 1, 3 is the old pole 1. So two daughters of cell number 2, 2 times 2, 2 times 2 plus 1, 4, 5. And again, the two daughters of 3 are 6 and 7. And so you see, there is a nice way to number my population. And if I take any number, I know exactly where it is on the genealogical tree. Okay. So this is one of the first studies I did that I'm not going to present here. We use this model, okay? We define the autoregressive model. We put fairly general assumptions on the noise. And we could build least squares estimators. Said, okay, they have really nice properties. They converge almost surely to the desired value. They have asymptotic normality under quite mild assumptions. Okay, nice. And actually, we did this work before we got the data, because now I'm telling you a story, but in real life, it didn't happen in this order. We had the model first and the data next. So when we had the model, okay, we were really happy. Well, we have a great model. Now we need data to test it. And in the first model we did, we absolutely did not think that there could be missing points in my tree. So first estimation procedure requires to have observations of all the growth rates of all the cells up to a given generation. which is absolutely not true, it's the data. So we could not run our estimation procedure. We said, okay, let's make another model to take into account that some data are not observed. So what do you want from an observation model to take into account that there are some data that are not measured? Well, we want to test symmetry. So of course, we want a possibly asymmetric observation scheme. So we need the probability to be observed to depend on the type of the mother and the type of the daughter. Possibly, if the mother was an old pole cell and its daughter is a new pole one, maybe you don't have the same probability to be observed as if you have a new pole mother and an old pole daughter. You want something that is quite true from the data. If a cell is not observed, none of its daughters and granddaughters and great-granddaughters are. So basically, you just trim the whole branch in the tree. And usually, it's what happens because I'll get back to this later on. You forget that it is some kind of continuous time, so if one cell was slower than the others, but you won't see its offspring by the end of your experiment, whereas if one has been faster, you will see many more of its offspring. You want, because it's easier, that if you take sister cells in the same generation, maybe they have a correlation to be observed or not, because again, they are born at the same time, at the same place. But say if you take cousins in the same generation, they can be independent, okay? And you want, which may not be reasonable again, independence between the observation process and the bar process. If you are observed, it does not depend on your growth rates, it depends on completely external causes. So this led us to propose a two-type Galton-Watson model for the observations, which is as follows. You will denote by delta k the indicator that cell k has been observed or not. So delta k is 1 if the cell is observed, 0 if it's not. You have a probability to be observed that depends on the type of your mother. Is your mother old or new? And you have a probability to have, if you have, say, an old mother, you have this probability to have exactly J0 daughter of type 1 and J1 daughters of type 2 that have been observed. Of course, J0 and 1 can be only 0 of 1, 0 or 1, because you have at most one daughter of each type. So you can have see either none of your daughters, two of them, or just one of them, with different probabilities. So this Galton-Watson process can be characterized by its descendance matrix, where you sum up all these probabilities, which is, I forgot to translate that, the mean number of daughters of type 0 of a mother of type I, and the mean number of daughters of type 1 for a mother of type I. If you are familiar with one-type Galton-Watson processes, you know that the fate of your process, which means extinction or not, depend on the mean of the reproduction distribution. So here, you are in dimension 2, so it's not the mean that will give you extinction or not, it's the highest eigenvalue of this descendance matrix, so its spectral radius. If it's smaller than 1, and like in the classical Galton-Watson process, you will go to extinction almost surely. If it's greater than 1, you have a probability of extinction that is smaller than 1. So what is extinction here? It is that I'm not seeing, after a finite number of generations, I'm not observing anyone anymore. Of course, I want to do asymptotic statistics, so I need to have observation up to infinity. So I want to be in the second case. I want to have a probability of extinction that is not 1. Okay? So let's get back to my model under partial observation. What are the parameters of interest? There are plenty of them. The main ones are the coefficients of the regressions. Remember, my aim is to decide if AB is the same as CD or not. because I want to test symmetry. To do that, I will need extra parameters. I told you, for instance, to build confidence interval or to build a test, you need to have a convergence in distribution to a known distribution. So it means you need to know the asymptotic variance of your data. So I need to have an estimation of the variance and covariance of the noise in my autoregressive process because I will need them to build my test statistics. And then there are plenty of non-necessary parameters that I can estimate if I want, but I don't need to. And just out of curiosity, I can estimate the higher order moments of the noise, and I can estimate all the coefficients of my Galton-Watson process. I can do it. I don't need to, but I can do it. Okay, so what estimation method did we choose? We didn't specify any distribution of the noise, so it rules out the likelihood method. And we chose the least squares method. So we want to minimize the error. So what is the error? The noise. So what we observe is the growth rate of a daughter cell. And if we believe that the autoregression is true, it should be close to this expression of its mother cell. So we want to minimize the square of this expression. So this is for the new polled cell and the same for the old polled cell. And we pull all that. And which ones do we take into account? Only the observed ones, because of course, if we don't see them, we don't have any information. Okay. So this is the quantity we need to minimize. So here I give you a notation, I'm not sure I'm going to use it much, but all the cells in generation n, I will note that jn, and all the cells in the tree up to generation n, I will note that tn. Okay, so it's basically all the integers up to 2 to the n plus 1 minus 1. Okay, and so that's for the all the cells in generation n, all the cells in the trees, and for restricting to the observed cells, I will just put a star. So it's just the same, but only the observed ones. Okay. So I have an analytical expression for my estimator of ABCD, just solving my least squares minimization. It's quite straightforward. You write things down. So it's a bit ugly there, but what do you do? You just take your growth rates and the multiples of your growth rate by that of your mother. Of course, you only take into account those that you observe. And what you would expect if you didn't take into account that, or if all cells are observed. So you just remove the deltas here. And what you have here in the normalizing matrix would be exactly the same expression. Okay, remove the deltas, and you have twice the same. What is the little trick here is that what is the most naive approach when you have missing data? You take your estimator as if you had all the data, and you just take the one you see. So it would mean that I take this matrix, I multiply not by delta 2k and delta 2k plus 1, but by delta k, each one, and I will have my value here. So here, why do I have delta 2k and delta 2k plus 1? Because I will take into account the growth rates of my of a mother cell only if I have seen its even or its odd daughter. So it's not completely what you would expect from the naive approach as a normalizing constant, the normalizing thing here. So it's a bit more tricky, but it's the result of the least squares minimization. So you can compute everything. You can see that although it's a bit ugly to write, but all you need to have is the growth rates, the observed growth rates of your population, so you can compute that. Okay, so you can prove that this estimator converges to the right value. Again, with a trick, what do I mean here? If I see someone in generation n, when n goes to infinity, okay? If I am on the extinction set, I won't see anything, and nothing happens at the limit, of course. So on the non-extinction set, I know exactly that my parameter converges to the right one, and I know at which rate it converges. So I have an idea of the speed of convergence. And I also have the asymptotic normality that, and I can have an expression, again it's very ugly, but I have an expression of the limiting matrix here. So now we have a formula, nice. You have super good properties for the estimator, nice. Let's run it on the data. What I showed you now is an estimation for one tree. I'm having a mother cell and its daughters and its granddaughters and so on. So take the largest tree in the data from Stewart. The largest tree has 663 cells observed up to generation 9. Here is the value you get for the estimation of A, B, C, and D. Okay, they look different. The confidence interval don't overlap. Great, it means statistically they are different. You can build from the asymptotic normality, you can build a test statistic to properly test the symmetry assumption. So here's the formula, but you don't need to know it. And again, when you run it on the largest tree, H0 is rejected, so you reject symmetry. Fine, so it is asymmetric, great. But we didn't stop there, this is one tree. We have 100 trees. So let's try it on the other trees. So now, I need to take you to a bit more advanced level about hypothesis testing. There is an interesting information you get from a test, which you may have heard of. It's the p-value of a test. What is the p-value of a test? It's the smallest error level alpha such that H0 is rejected, which means that if you don't want to set a type 1 error, say, okay, maybe it's 5%, maybe it's 1%, I don't know, I'm not sure. Another way to put it is to compute the p-value of the test, which is the minimum error that will get you H0 rejected. Okay, for instance, if your p-value is below 5%, you know that H0 is rejected with a type 1 error of 5%. Okay? Under H0, you know the distribution of your test statistics, and then you know the distribution of the p-values. It should be uniform. So if H0 is true, you run your test on several data sets, you should get something like uniformity. And if H1 is true, you should only get small p-values because you will be rejected all the time. So when we run our estimation procedure on the, say, 50 biggest trees with 8 to 9 generations, what do we get? Here are the p-values. Do we reject H0? Absolutely not. It's not quite uniform, but it's not just everything below 5%. What does it mean? So if I take well-selected tree, it's not symmetric. If I take all of them, I don't really know. Symmetry cannot be rejected. So what? I'll get back to my type 2 error. Remember, I know exactly what is a type 1 error. I choose it. So I say I want a type 1 error of 5%. What is the power of my test? So what is the probability that I reject H0 if H0 is not true? I want it to be high, but is it high? Then you run, and it's usually what is done to evaluate the power of a test, plenty of simulations. So we simulated a lot of samples from our model. So the nice thing is when you can simulate is you know exactly if your model is true or not. So you know exactly if you're under H0 or H1. And you try. Under H0, you see you have about 5% of rejection, which is exactly what you expect. And here you have the number of observed generations. But under H1, if you have 7 generations, the probability to reject H1 under H1 is 35, to reject H0, well, the power is 30%, it's really, really poor. H generation, 50%, which means you just toss a coin and you decide, do I reject or not? There is no information there. 9 generations, 70%, so it's really, really poor power. If you want reasonably high power, you need to get to 10 or 11 generations, which is out of the range of our data because we have at most 9 generations. So it means that, okay, actually I cannot conclude anything from this picture because the power of my test is not good enough to be able to decide with only 8 to 9 generations. So what do we do now? Do we stop there? No. This is a single tree estimation. We have plenty of replicated trees, so we should be able to get information from that. So let's say now I want to use that I have several replications of my trees. And I'm going to do something like, looks like a bit like aggregation of estimators, except that if I wanted to aggregate estimator, I would take a mean of all my estimations over all trees. And then again, because of this term here, it's outside the sum and not inside, so it's not quite like aggregating estimators. But again, I'm going to minimize some least square error, but instead of doing this tree by tree, I'm doing it for all the trees at the same time. And then I know that my trees are independent from one another, so it's not so difficult. So then I have these very, very ugly formulas, where J now is the number of the tree, but again, it's something I can absolutely compute from my data. So let's do that. And now, of course, I can use my 23,000 data. So now I can, it's powerful. And here's the final estimation we get for parameter A and B, C and D. You see that, again, the confidence intervals, they don't overlap much. And you can test the equality of AB to CD, and you reject it with a p-value that is 10 to the minus 5. So we can say now, if we pull all the data together, that from the data, we can rule out symmetry. Okay. And as I told you before, we don't need to, but we can estimate the coefficients of the Galton-Watson process, which means what are the probability to see, to observe any of the cells. I told you I need to be far from extinction, so I need a spectral radius greater than 1. We can see on the data it's estimated at 1.2, so it's valid. And again, you can test if, given that your mother is old or given that your mother is new, do you have the same probability to be observed or not? Statistically not, but I'm not sure you can get really some interesting knowledge from that. But you can do it. Okay. So I stop here for the first data set. Okay, I can now say, yes, it is not symmetric, but you see that I really need much more work than in just the single drawing I showed you in the beginning. If I want to take into account the tree structure of the data, if I want to take into account the missing data, and if I want to take into account that I observe a small number of generations. Okay, now let's get to the other data set. So this one is a bit different because for this one, I got the original data in continuous time. Or when I say continuous, it's not really true because it's film, so you have one observation each minute. And E. coli divides about every 20 minutes. So you have a measurement of the length each minute until division. And then in the first file, I already had the pre-processed data with the growth rates. Now I don't have the growth rates, I just have the length of the cell over time, so I need to compute the growth rate. Okay. So here we got 448 files corresponding to 224 channels, because for each channel we measure the old pole cell that is trapped in the bottom and its sister. Okay, so it's why I have twice more files than channels. And we have one file for old pole cells and one file for new pole cells, okay? We have, again, a lot of information that we don't need in the files. We have here an index that is just the time, 0 minute, 1 minute, 2 minutes, etc. You have here an index of division, so it's just the beginning of the file, so you see no division here, but when you have a division, you will get a one here, and you will see a drop in the length of the cell. So then again, we need to compute the growth rates, and we need to build the genealogies again. So how do we compute the growth rates? We just run a regression, standard regression, exponential regression, on the length of the cells. And then first problems come, because we had the raw data. They weren't pre-processed at all, so they weren't filtered at all. And we had plenty of outliers, giving completely irrelevant. For instance, we had cells with negative lengths. What does that mean? Or cell with positive lengths, but when you compute the rate, you find a negative growth rate. Not so good. So you want to rule them out, which means that we have removed some of the trees. We had to tidy the data a little bit. We didn't use them all. We got rid of the small trees. The typical length is 100 to 200 generations, but we have some very small ones with less than 20 generations, so this one we just dumped. If the mean growth rate is too far from the global mean of all the other trees, we put them away also, saying it's an outlier, it's not normal. And in a single tree, we also removed the growth rates of the cells that were too far from the median of the other cells in the same tree, because, again, saying it's outliers. Why do we rule all that out? Because here is a sample of what you can see. You have the growth rate here of all the cells in tree, so it's still the generations here. So you can see that it's fairly stable, like the original paper concluded, but then you have here some negative values, we don't want them. And usually towards the end of the experiment, you start to see strange things, so you want to erase this phenomenon too. So this is a not so bad example, so where you just want to cancel a few points. Another typical example, everything is good, and in the end, something strange happens, so you want again to remove the end of the trees, and then you have completely erratic trees like this one, where you have points very high, points very low, you really don't know why. And then again, most of the time, it just gets strange in the end. So there is a lot of work to tidy the data. Then I tell you we have a question is still the symmetry. Now I have one file with the new pole cell and one file with the old pole cell, and they are in two different files, so I need to resynchronize them. So now the good thing is I have the almost continuous time data, I can completely plot the growth rate, the length of the set, which I couldn't do with the first set. So here, if I wanted, I could fit a PDMP model, and it is exactly what Marie Dumic will show you, I think, tomorrow and the day after. So you can do that, and you can estimate its intensity, but it's not my question here. So you can see that in the beginning, okay, they seem to get born at the same dates, fine. And then you have some strange phenomena, then you have one that is quite strange, and again in the end you have strange things, and then you have just one that seems to have divided and not the other. So again, there is a lot of cleaning to be done with this data in order to have a homogeneous enough data set to start from. So as a summary, we have 224 channels. You have 6 to 300 observed generations, 45,000 cells, so quite rich data set, some missing data, some data that we removed because we consider them outliers. We got an estimation of the growth rate. And again, we can keep track of which is old and which is new, and the old is accumulated old pole on several generations, but the new one is always new from one generation on, because it always stems from the old generation, the old pole cell. And we know the genealogy and we know the lineage in each channel. So the exploratory analysis. What if I take all the data together and pull it by generation? So here, as I have many more generations, I didn't plot you all the 200 generations, but just some from the beginning and from the middle and from the end. And again, you can see the general dispersion of my data. Okay. So we had a procedure that worked well on the first data set. We had, okay, we had this bar model, this autoregressive model. Fine. Okay, so let's try it on this data too. We have, we just need to change a bit the Galton-Watson process so that we only keep the information from the old polar branch, but it can be done, no problem. Except that, what do we get here? Estimation for A, B, C, D, okay, fine. If you're just looking at this part, okay, seems happy, you have values, great. But if you are looking at the confidence intervals, what happens? You see that zero belongs to the confidence interval of B, and you see that zero belongs to the confidence interval of D. What does it mean? Remember, my model is as follows. I have x 2k plus 1 is a plus b times xk plus some noise, and I have that x, 2k. 2k plus 1 is c plus d times xk times epsilon 2k plus 1. Now, if I have zero in the confidence interval of B and D, what does it mean? It means that I cannot reject the assumption that B equals to zero and D equals to zero. But if B equals to zero and D equals to zero, what do I have there? Just noise. So no information. So it means that these data are too noisy for this estimation to be relevant. I'm just observing noise. I cannot rule out that I have observed only noise. So of course I cannot draw any conclusion on the noise. So I cannot validate a probabilistic model. So I will turn to a statistical model just to try to see if there is a link between the data of a different sort. So now as I know that I'm going from the old pole to the old pole to the old pole, I can just test a simple regression model where I see now I've changed the numbering of my cells. It's just the old pole cell from generation n, the old pole cell from generation n plus 1, and the old pole cell from generation n minus 1. What does it mean? It means that I want to see if there is a significant link between one cell, its mother, and its grandmother. So let's try that. What do I get for the significance of the mother? I get for good p-values. Now I know that I can reject non-significance of the mother. So okay, so this parameter here, beta m, is non-zero. Fine. Let's see if I have information from my grandmother. Answer? Now you're all very good at statistics. You can say, no, there is no information from the grandmother. You have a uniform distribution. You cannot reject that it's not significant. So you cannot reject that beta g is zero, which is rather good news because it means that my previous model was not too stupid because the information really comes from the mother and not from the older generations. We tried several other things, but this is the most significant one. Now, I want to try to see if there is a difference between the old pole cells and the new pole cells. For the old pole cells, it really makes sense to have this autoregression process because I really see one cell, its daughter, and so on. For the new pole cell, it doesn't really make sense, but there's not much else we can do because I'm on this branch of the tree, so I see all the old pole cells, fine, and the new one is its sister, and its sister, and its sister, and its sister. So the genealogical relationship between these, it's not direct, but there's not much else I can do. So I will fit exactly the same kind of data. And so here is an histogram of the parameter for the mother for the old pole cells. And for the new pole cells, it's, I don't know if you can see it, looks different, and it is statistically significantly different. So you can test if the two parameters, beta m for the old pole cells and beta m for the new pole cells agree, and then the test says no, they don't agree. So there is also some asymmetry in this data set? It wasn't the original question from the biological experiment because they were interested in the cumulative old pole growth rate, but there is still significant asymmetry in this data set. Okay, so now I'll go to the conclusion. Remember my question were, are the two experiments in contradiction? Yes or no? And is the division of E. coli symmetric? So I've already told you the answer. Is it symmetric? Yes, in both data sets, there is statistically significant asymmetry between the growth rates of the old pole and the new pole cells. And what you could have seen directly from my drawings here, this one, where is it? There. You can see that from the first data set, the data are not stationary. Why? Because how did they do this experiment? They let the cells grow, pick one, put it in a new medium, and let it grow again. And when you pick a cell and put it in a new medium, it is stressed. And it takes a few generations to get to its stationary growth rate. And actually, that's what you see here in this pooled data. Whereas on the other data set, they knew that when you put a cell in a new medium, it is stressed, it is different. So actually, they removed from the experiment the first few generations. So we don't have them. So we have just the stationary phase, and you can see that here it's completely stable. So why do the two experiments disagree? Well, mostly because one is in the transient phase and the other is in the stationary phase. And what the statistician can ask for is new experiments in between, please, so that we can understand what happens. Okay, and I'll stop here with a number of references I've noted. And you can discuss all sorts of limitations to the models I've showed you. There are plenty of reasons to rule them out. And especially, I'm looking at discrete time autoregressions when I know that my observations are in continuous time. And my Galton-Wasson process to decide if I have observed the data or not is especially not relevant because I should have rather some time sensor. I should say that if this one has been slower, I haven't seen it, and it's not that I haven't. There is a mechanism that says I haven't seen it. So what you really should do is study this data set in continuous time. And again, this is ongoing work where we are trying to understand. There is a lot of information in this data set and a lot more we can do. And we try to understand the asymmetry of division from the continuous time point of view with PDMP models. And already in the very basic model I gave you yesterday and this morning for cell growth and fragmentation, the PDMP model, remember I told you take an intensity for the jump to be a multiple of the size or to be a multiple of the time. Both of them are not really realistic. And again, see Marie Dumick-Stock to see what it looks like. But I also told you the division kernel is divided by half. And then you could ask, well, is it exactly the half or not? And from this data, we try to have a look at that. And we saw that actually, now, we believe in asymmetry. So there are faster cells and slower cells. But in the end, in your experiments, you don't see big, big cells and you don't see small ones. You see all of them, they have, from the naked eyes, they have the same size. So it means that there is some kind of balance. And we could estimate that actually the old pole cells get a bit more than the half of the mother cell because it will grow slower. And and you can really see that from the data. And the new pole cell gets the smaller half because it will grow faster. And in the end, you have some kind of stable equilibrium. And this is what we are trying to understand now. So thank you for your attention. I'll stop here.